Thanks for coming again. I really appreciate it. You know, 3 days in a row is a time commitment, so I don't take it for granted. So on the first day, via a discussion of Althusser and Meillassoux, we talked about the relationship between the distinction between rationalism and empiricism, and the distinction between idealism and materialism. And then on the second day, via discussion of Althusser and Théorie Communiste, linked by Spinoza, I was concerned with this criterion of immanence that Althusser takes from Spinoza and that maybe he doesn't fulfill, and that we might think about the work of Théorie Communiste as a certain way of addressing, so sustaining that criterion of immanence. So I think that today, in a discussion of mostly Hegel and Quentin Meillassoux, we'll maybe link these problems. That is to say, what's at issue in maintaining a certain Hegelian criterion of immanence in terms of the relationship between rationalism and empiricism? And how does Hegel fail to sustain a certain criterion of immanence within his own thought? And how can that be remedied, maybe, by a thinking of a relationship between absolute contingency and absolute time? So that's sort of the problem of this piece. And this piece is, okay, so this piece, what it's doing is, in this book project, it's taking two chapters, one just on Hegel, and one on the relationship between Hegel and Meillassoux, and yoking them together. So I sort of been at work on that today. So this is sort of work in progress at this point. But let me, the second half of it is work in progress. So let me begin then with a certain argument about Hegel's science of logic. So this paper is called Speculative Idealism, Speculative Materialism, right? So what's at stake in this use of, this conversion of speculative idealism into speculative materialism by Meillassoux? So speculative idealism, speculative materialism, Hegel, Heidegger, Meillassoux. Heidegger just gets a reference, but actually he's quite important at the end of this piece. So I think that any valid approach to the science of logic, to Hegel's science of logic, depends upon being able to recognize it as two things at the same time. So first, a critique of pre-Kantian metaphysics, dogmatic metaphysics, and secondly, a critique of Kant's transcendental philosophy. Okay, so just two basic criteria that have to be held together. Nothing new. So first of all, a critique of pre-Kantian metaphysics. Hegel criticizes pre-Kantian metaphysics for, he says, erroneously applying pure forms of thought to such figurative substrata as soul, world, and God. Right? So it takes the pure forms of thought and it applies them to these figurative substrata without previously investigating whether and how these pure forms of thought could determine the thing in itself. Right? So that's the problem with dogmatic metaphysics. So Hegel says that in the introduction to the logic, he intends a true critique of the determination of things in themselves by the pure forms of thought. He uses this term true critique. And he says, the objective logic is therefore the true critique of such determinations, not according to the abstract form of the a priori, as contrasted with the a posteriori, but in themselves according to their particular content. Okay, so this is a key point that I want to hold on to. For Hegel, the science of logic does not obey the opposition of the a priori and the a posteriori. Okay, secondly, think of the logic as a critique of Kant's transcendental philosophy. So Hegel rejects the transcendental framework of Kantian critique due to, he says, the attachment of determinations of thought to the I as the subject of thinking. Hegel says that in order to cognize the infinite forms of thought, what he calls the concept, the finite determinateness of the I as consciousness must be shed. Okay, so true critique for Hegel, first of all, subjects the forms of thought to a critique in the particular content of their determinations. True critique does not obey the opposition of the a priori and the a posteriori. And true critique does not suture pure forms of thought to the I as the subject of thinking. Okay, so he wants to go both beyond dogmatic metaphysics and transcendental philosophy for these reasons. Okay, so first of all, how do we shed the I of transcendental critique while also performing what Hegel thinks of as an immanent critique of the forms of thought themselves? How do we do that without the eye of transcendental critique? So for Hegel, we do this through an interrogation of thought by thought, right, in its immanent movement, the thinking of thinking itself. So for example, at the opening of the logic, there's an implicit structure that I refer to as Hegel's cogito, and this is the title of an article that I've published in Parisia on Hegel's logic. Hegel's cogito. So the first chapter of the logic begins with a statement, with the sentence, being pure being. So when we say, when we think or write, being pure being, then thought is, thought exists, thought appears, made actual in language. Okay, without explicitly stating it, the thinking of being indexed in the sentence by language makes manifest the being and existence of thought at the opening of Hegel's logic. So how does a simple structure like this function as a form of true critique? Well, at the beginning of the logic, as soon as we think being pure being, then Hegel says, his argument, famous argument, is that being has already passed over into nothingness through its absence of determination, right? Precisely through its purity. To think it as pure and undetermined is to think it as nothing. This absence of determination by which we think pure being as nothingness is a determination, and thus a becoming of pure being, which forces it through its contradiction with nothingness into the movement of thought, into becoming, Hegel's argument at the beginning of the logic. Spinoza says, all determination is negation. But we see here that even an absence of determination is negation. It's still, that is to say, a determination. The negative infects pure being, this absence of determination, through the determinations of thought. Right? When we try to think pure being, we have to think it as nothingness, and then the transition between being and nothingness is becoming, right? We're actually thinking being as becoming through this negation, this absence of determination, which converts it through contradiction into nothing. So this is an example, in the terms that I used on the first day, of drawing what has to be said from the immanent experience of what happens in thought. And it constitutes a certain kind of epistemological framework for the thinking of being. This is my argument. So ontology, the philosophy of being, is a discourse, right? Insofar as it is a rational discourse, what it can say of being is constrained by what has to be said. And the necessity of what has to be said is drawn from the rational coherence of the contingent process of thinking. Hegel's epistemology is inextricable from his ontology, as he says, for him, logic is metaphysics, because what can be said of being proves inextricable from the immanent determinations of what has to be said, right? The contingent experience of thinking unfolds through the necessary movements of its structure. So for Hegel, the I of such a movement of thinking only emerges in thought as thought's self-criticism. The productive process of its negative explication, that is to say, the dialectic. And Hegel's radicality in relation to Kant consists in recognizing that what Kant calls the unity of apperception, the I, cannot be transcendental if it is also to be critical. The immanent deduction of the I in Hegel rather than a transcendental deduction, is the genetic movement of the concept itself. It is the imminent critique of thinking by the process of thinking itself. You know, that's how we arrive at the genesis of the I as the concept in Hegel. So with this in mind, let me outline four orientations in modern thought. So first of all, rationalism is the a priori determination of what is the case on the basis of what has to be thought. For Spinoza, for example, right? We have to think substance as absolutely infinite. It can't be divided into two substances in the mode of Descartes. So reason obeys what has to be thought, right? And it's the a priori determination of what is the case on the basis of what has to be thought. That is, rationalism investigates the determinations of reason according to their order and consistency. And Spinoza's ethics would be, in my opinion, the best example of that form of rationalism. Second, empiricism is the a posteriori determination of what is the case on the basis of what happens. It investigates the determinations of experience according to their order and consistency. Right? So rather than the determinations of reason, the determinations of experience. And it's a posteriori, it's based upon experience. Okay, third, transcendental critique, right? Kant's transcendental critique displaces the opposition between rationalism and empiricism in pre-critical metaphysics. And for Kant, transcendental critique is the a priori determination of what has to be the case for things to happen as they do, right? That is, it investigates the conditions of possibility for experience to have order and consistency. Right? So it's a kind of fusion of rationalism and empiricism in that way. What has to be the case for things to happen as they do in experience? And it's the a priori determination of that. Fourth, immanent critique, as in Hegel, is the processual explication of what happens in the course of thinking what is the case. Right? The course of thinking what is the case. It investigates the order and consistency of the experience of thinking itself. Right, the order and consistency of the experience of thinking being as it determines itself. Okay, so these four orientations in modern thought that have to do with basically with the relation between what has to be thought and what happens. Hegel's critical metaphysics is a true critique or an immanent critique of both dogmatic metaphysics and Kantian transcendental critique insofar as it is what I call a form of rationalist empiricism. That is to say, it's going to link in a sort of synthesis rationalism and empiricism in a non-transcendental mode. In Hegel's logic, the I is neither dogmatically posited nor transcendentally deduced. It cannot be arrived at a priori. Rather, thought first appears on the scene through the thinking of being, and the I is arrived at through the experience of the order and consistency of thinking, only in the at the end of the logic. So Hegel will say, the content and determination of the concept can be proven solely on the basis of an immanent deduction, which contains its genesis, and such a deduction lies behind us, Hegel says. So Hegel, in this sense, Hegel is a rationalist, because the content and the determination of the concept involves a deduction, right? It is a deduction. But he's an empiricist because it depends upon an experience of thought that is determinate of the concept, and that, as he puts it, already lies behind us. That is to say, it's a posteriori. So Hegel's immanent critique is both a priori and a posteriori. The name I assign to the methodological position of such an immanent deduction is rationalist empiricism. So the question is then, how can this support an epistemology? If we get rid of the transcendental framework of Kant's epistemology, how can Hegel's immanent critique, thought thinking its own determinations, claim any sort of epistemological coherence? Right? How can we understand, if you want, its theory of knowledge? Or its claim to be valid knowledge? How can it support an epistemology? So, immanent critique involves exposing the necessity of rationality, right? Rationality is necessary thinking. How can it expose the necessity of rationality, that is to say, what has to be thought, to the contingency of what happens, the experience of thought as it takes place, right? So we have to expose the necessity of rationality to the contingency of what happens. And also, retroactively, we have to derive the necessity of rationality from its contingent movement. That's how Hegel's immanent critique works. So the negativity of thought is crucial to this kind of dialectical movement. But how can the movement of thought, the articulation of thinking being, be both necessary and contingent, right? This is the problem. How does it make sense, right, to say that we sort of move between the contingency and the necessity of thought, and that immanent critique is both necessary and contingent, and therefore involves both rationalism and empiricism, right? That it actually traverses both the contingency of thinking and the necessity of what has to be thought. So how can we say that coherently? We have an answer to this question in Hegel's Logic of Essence, we have to answer this question because the co-determination of necessity and contingency, the necessity and contingency of thinking, provides Hegel's immanent critique with its immanent epistemology, right? It's the relation of necessity and contingency which, if you will, check one another and give his thought some epistemological, a critical dimension. So how can we say that it's both at the same time necessary and contingent? Well, we get an answer to this question in the Logic of Essence. So that is to say, the central section of Hegel's Science of Logic. And we get an answer through the relation between the chapter on actuality and the chapter on ground in Hegel's Logic of Essence. And so the task is to arrive at an interpretation of these chapters that is at once epistemological and ontological, that bears upon the coherence of thinking and the theory of being at the same time. And here I rely a little bit on articles by Stephen Hulgate and Rayoni Padui, which in turn draw upon articles by Dieter Henrich, George DiGiovanni, and John Burbidge, right? So this is an old problem in Hegel, obviously, the relationship between necessity and contingency, and particularly in the Logic of Essence. So this is my graph. I hope that's legible. So I'll take this up and explain it. So what's at issue in the relation between Hegel's account of necessity and contingency? What's at issue in that account of necessity and contingency is their relation to the categories of actuality and possibility. So this is what's up in the graph. So if we start at the left side and we take y and not y, okay? We say that if y is possible, that is to say if it's only possible, well then not y is also possible. One of these two is going to become actual, right? Either y or not y. But Hegel also points out that possibility itself is something actual, right? Because either y or not y can or will come to be in the future, then both y or not y may be in the future, right? So both are possible at the present, right? Possibility is something actual. So if y comes to be the case, which is what happens on this graph here, you see y on the other side of actuality, if y comes to be the case, its existence is contingent. That is to say, it could have been otherwise, right? This could have been depends upon the actuality of the initial possibility, right? That is to say, the status of y is merely possible, right? That's what makes y contingent when it comes to be the case. And this actuality of the initial possibility, right, the state of why or not why, is what Hegel defines, is why Hegel defines contingency as the unity of possibility and actuality. Okay, that's Hegel's definition of contingency, the unity of possibility and actuality. Moreover, there's a sense in which contingency is necessary, since possibility is actual. It is possible that either Y or not Y will be the case. So if Y becomes actual, again, its existence is contingent. But if Y is determined as possible, then it is necessary that either Y will be the case or not. And in this sense, contingency is necessary. Right? These are Hegel's arguments in these chapters. So Hegel says, the contingent is therefore necessary because the actual is determined as possible. Contingency is therefore necessary because the actual is determined as possible, because there's such thing as possibility, if you like. Now, Hegel theorizes this as formal actuality and formal possibility. Okay, so formal possibility is what I have there as we move to a new structure of possibility, either A or not A, right? Formal actuality or formal possibility bear upon whether or not something will become the case, right? But Hegel also theorizes real actuality or real possibility. And these involve determinations, circumstances, and conditions of what is actually the case. So if we look at A, right? We have A in the position of A and not A in the position of Y and not Y, right? Same setup. That's the dimension of formal possibility. But now we want to think not only of the possibility of the fact of the existence of one or the other, but also the internal determination of the fact, right? So then what happens? Well, how do we get to A rather than not A, right? Well, we move through certain conditions and determinations and circumstances, and then A becomes the case rather than not A, although both of them were possible in this dimension of formal possibility. Now, Hegel will say that this is the point at which A becomes the case is the point of real possibility, right? Real possible. Now it is really possible, not just formally possible, that A can be the case. And he says, real possibility constitutes the totality of conditions for a fact to be the case, right? Constitutes the totality of conditions. That's real possibility. And he says, whenever all the conditions of a fact are completely present, the fact is actually there. He says, when all the conditions of a fact are at hand, the fact steps into concrete existence. Beautiful formulation in Hegel, I think. When all the conditions of a fact are at hand, the fact steps into concrete existence. That is to say, when something is really possible, rather than simply formally possible, it can no longer be otherwise. Or if you want, it is necessary. So Hegel says, real possibility is already itself necessity. Okay, the real possibility of a contingent being makes its existence necessary. And so here we have, again, a unity of contingency and necessity as what Hegel calls absolute actuality. Okay, when A is really possible, it is. And so then we can say that A is both necessary at the point of real possibility and it's contingent at the point of formal possibility. So that's how something can coherently be both necessary and contingent, according to Hegel's dialectical logic. And that's absolute actuality, this unity of contingency and possibility in the fact. Hegel claims, then, that contingency becomes in necessity. Interesting claim. Contingency becomes a necessity. He says, in fact, contingency is necessity's own becoming. This bears upon Hegel's ontological claim that being is the identity of absolute necessity and absolute contingency. This is an interesting argument. Being is the identity of absolute necessity and absolute contingency. Okay. Fascinating argument, simple argument. Being is actual, but being itself as unconditioned, being pure being, unconditioned, right? Being itself as unconditioned has no ground. It's grounded on nothing. It's pure, if you want. That is to say, it's unconditioned. Because it is without ground, because it's unconditioned, being is absolutely contingent. That is to say, it has no sufficient reason. It's absolutely contingent in the sense that it has no sufficient reason. But because it is unconditioned, because it is without ground, being is absolutely necessary. Why? Because there is no ground of possibility for it not to be. So, being is the identity of absolute contingency and absolute necessity. That's actually something like a concept of pure being, I would say, in Hegel. Dialectically determined through the relation between necessity and contingency and an absence of conditions. Okay, now, being is the identity of absolute contingency and absolute necessity, right? If you're Kant, in Kant's cosmological antinomies, it's exactly arguments like this that show that when reason goes beyond possible experience, it arrives at contradictions, and thus at a null result, right? That's the point of Kant's dialectic in the cosmological antinomies. If you ask something like, is being necessary or contingent, you're going to end up in these contradictions. You can make arguments that both are the case. And therefore, you get a null result, and that's the problem with the speculative use of reason. However, Hegel's speculative thinking hinges upon the claim that the identity of opposing terms, their contradiction, is dialectically and rationally productive, right? That is, as the identity of absolute necessity and absolute contingency, being is becoming, right? We don't arrive at a null result. The contradiction generates the movement of thinking being, and we get a new concept, becoming. Okay, so the chapter on actuality that I've just analyzed and added a little bit to offers a theory of how the identity and of contingency and necessity can be coherently thought. Okay, but to further elucidate the dialectical productivity of this ontological contradiction, we need to turn to a crucial passage from Hegel's chapter on ground. Okay, and this is my favorite passage in Hegel. This, I think, is the most important passage in the Phenomenology of Spirit, or the Science of Logic. This very interesting passage from the chapter on ground in the Logic. So this is from the final section of that chapter, which is called Procession of the Fact into Concrete Existence, right? It steps into existence. Procession of the Fact into Concrete Existence. So here, Hegel follows the conditions of a fact's existence into the groundlessness of being. So that is to say, that sounds metaphysical, but it's quite simple. You follow the conditions of a fact's existence. Why does it exist? What conditions its existence? You get more and more conditions. You follow them absolutely. You infinitely, you end up in the groundlessness of being. And so here's the passage where Hegel thinks about this, following the conditions of a fact's existence into the groundlessness of being. And again, a very important passage for thinking about Hegel's ontology. So he says, the conditions are the whole content of the fact. Because they are the unconditioned in the form of formless being. We'll come back to this. But because of this form, they also have yet another shape besides the conditions of this content as it is, as this is in the fact as such. They also have another shape than that, these conditions. They appear as a manifold without unity, mingled with extra essential elements and other circumstances that do not belong to the circle of existence as constituting the conditions of this determinate fact. For the absolute, unrestricted fact, the sphere of being itself is the condition. Okay, the sphere of being, it's actually in German, die Sphäre des Seins, right? So it is sphere, sfera, right? The sphere of being is the condition of those determinate facts that belong to what Hegel calls the circle of existence. And he actually does distinguish between these, dem Kreise, de Dasein, okay? So one, sphera and Kreise, right? Sphere and circle, sphere of being, circle of existence. Nice formulations about the difference, the ontological difference, basically, in Hegel. Facts in the circle of existence refer, through their conditions, to their ground, ultimately, in the sphere of being. But the sphere of being itself is unconditioned. It is the absolute, unrestricted fact. Moreover, within the sphere of being, the conditions of any determinate, existent fact, these conditions within the sphere of being are a manifold without unity, mingled with extra essential elements. Elements, if you want, which don't pertain to the existence of this particular fact, right? And the conditions which do pertain to the existence of this particular fact are mingled with extra essential elements in a manifold without unity. Insofar as the conditions are the whole content of the fact is necessary. Within the circle of existence, the fact has to be as it is. That's real possibility. But insofar as those conditions are also mingled with extra essential elements and other circumstances in the sphere of being, it is contingent that precisely this fact, rather than another, comes to exist. Again, thinking the relation between contingency and necessity requires us to think the mediated relation between being and existence that Hegel calls actuality. Okay, so for example, the statement being pure being exists, right? And its existence has its condition in the being and existence of thought. If there were no thought, such a statement would not exist. As thinking being, it is actual. And this is why the statement implies another unspoken fact. Thought is, thought exists. And the existence of thinking being, its actuality, is in turn grounded in the sphere of being itself. Thus we can turn over the earlier figure, right? And we move from thought is, thought exists, and we pursue the determinations of the existence of thought into the sphere of being. It's contingent that thought exists in the circle of existence. In Hegel's chapter on ground, thinking finds its way from the contingent fact that it exists to the absolute, unrestricted fact that being is. Thinking investigates its groundless ground in being. Key ontological chapter in Hegel. Okay, so Hegel's analysis of contingency and necessity, which is also an analysis of the structural movement of thinking, is both epistemological and ontological. And I propose that we understand this genetic epistemology. Genetic epistemology, I mean, it emerges through the movement of thought, right? I propose that we understand this genetic epistemology through the modal relation between necessity and contingency in terms of the methodological relation between rationalism and empiricism. Okay, Hegel's analysis in the chapter on actuality allows us to understand how the movement between what happens and what has to be the case can coherently be grasped as both contingent and necessary. And it thus requires an approach that is both rationalist, what has to be said, and empiricist, what happens in thought. So the key to displacing both pre-critical metaphysics and transcendental critique through an immanent critique, this is the key, this relation between rationalism and empiricism via the relation between the contingency and necessity of thinking, is the key to displacing both pre-critical metaphysics and Kant's transcendental critique through an immanent critique, right? An immanent critique that is without epistemological guarantee, right? It can't be transcendentally guaranteed, but is not without epistemological coherence. Right? And its coherence is this movement between necessity and contingency and their co-determination in the movement of thinking. Okay. So that's a condensation of this article that I published on Hegel. And now, second part of the presentation. How does this relate to the problems that Quentin Meillassoux is grappling with in his work, and specifically his doctoral dissertation? And what does this have to do with the problem of time in Hegel? Okay, so now, critique of Hegel. Within Hegel's immanent critique of the pure forms of thought, and through them, the thinking of being, the encounter of reason with its own determinations is its becoming, the experience of thought informing itself as to its own imperatives. For Hegel, there is no a priori shortcut. And the labor of the concept involves an ungrounded alternation between the contingency and the necessity of thinking, through which each exfoliates the other. The becoming of the concept is its movement, the rationality of its experience, and the experience of its rationality. However, the processual unfolding of immanent critique does in fact arrive at a destination. So where, or when, if you like, or how, are we supposed to assign a stopping point to the development of the concept, in this movement of the concept? So to traverse and comprehend the concept at the end of Hegel's logic, the subjective logic, logic of the concept, to traverse and comprehend the concept is to gather its restlessness into resolution. And this arrival at what Hegel calls the pure concept conceptually comprehending itself, or what he calls the fulfilled concept, is what he calls the idea, right? So this is marked by a new name, right? Not the concept, but the idea. Marked by a new name, the advent of the idea as the fulfilled self-comprehension of the concept is indeed a stopping point in Hegel. He says, for the fulfilled concept, there is no transition that takes place, since, quote, the simple being to which the idea determines itself remains perfectly transparent to it. So the idea is transitionless. This perfect transparency is the obsolescence of the movement of a posteriori reflection. That is to say, it's the obsolescence, if you want, of the relevance of the a posteriori experience of thought. What do I mean by that? Well, the experience of thought is now so replete with determination that it is complete. The formidable paradox of Hegel's thought is that we arrive at the a priori by way of the a posteriori. This is how I would analyze the structure of the movement of the logic. This bizarre and paradoxical fact, we arrive at the a priori by way of the a posteriori. And in fact, this is the implicit logic of Hegel's notorious claim that the science of logic is, quote, the exposition of God in his eternal essence before the creation of nature and of finite spirit. This arrival at the completed a priori in the movement of the logic bears upon the problem of time. Okay, so in Hegel, so you get the earlier, right? It's like the movement of the logic is this relation. It's neither, or it's both a priori and a posteriori. But at the end, we shed the a posteriori, right? And we're now in the pure a priori, right? The exposition of God in his eternal essence before the creation of nature and of infinite spirit. And we get there via the relation between the a priori and the a posteriori. In Hegel, we in fact find, okay, and this has to do with time. So in Hegel, we in fact find a double annulment of time. It's a structural analysis of the problem of time in Hegel that involves a double annulment. So at the end of the Phenomenology of Spirit, right, last chapter, Hegel declares that spirit necessarily appears in time. Spirit necessarily appears in time just so long as it has not grasped its pure concept. That is to say, it appears in time as long as it has not annulled time. Time, therefore, appears as the destiny and necessity of spirit that is not yet replete within itself. Right? But absolute knowledge at the end of the phenomenology is this annulment of time by spirit, from which the logic starts out in the thinking of pure being. Yet in the logic, this time within the forms of pure thought, rather than within a phenomenological analysis of the development of spirit. And so now in the logic, we encounter, again, a sort of what Hegel would call a falling into time, right? As the unfolding within the movement of thought of the becoming of the concept. So we annul time at the end of the phenomenology of spirit, and then we move back into time through the thinking of being as becoming in the logic. Despite having attained absolute knowledge, the true critique of absolute knowledge, right, of the forms, of the pure forms of thought, has to undergo within itself the becoming of its determinations. So the canceling, and then the canceling of this becoming by its arrival at the absolute idea, is the second annulment of time in Hegel. So two annulments of time, one at the end of the phenomenology, one at the end of the logic, and in between the immanent critique of the movement of the concept. Between these two annulments of time, absolute knowledge and absolute idea, we find in the logic of essence a third absolute, what Hegel calls absolute becoming. Okay, so in the middle of the logic, this is the concept assigned by Hegel to the groundless becoming of the fact that I've already talked about a little bit, whose proximate conditions dissolve into a chain of determinations leading back into groundless indetermination in the sphere of being. So analyzed in this way, Hegel argues, through this sort of tracing of determinations back to their groundlessness, the singular fact, quote, rises up from the groundlessness the singular fact rises up from the groundless, that is, from its own essential negativity or pure form. It rises up from its own essential negativity or pure form, or from the groundless. So what's at stake again is the intervention of the absolute upon the progressive unfolding of determination, in this case, in the case of the fact. But in this case, what's at stake is not the absolute being of the concept, but rather the absolute becoming of the determinate fact, the absolutely unconditioned self-positing of a specific fact that is the unity of its contingency and its necessity. This is the very unity understood as becoming, as absolute becoming, that will be folded into the pure necessity of the idea by the cessation of transition at the end of the logic. Okay, so then three absolutes in Hegel. One, absolute knowledge, end of the phenomenology. Two, absolute becoming, middle of the phenomenology, this groundlessness of the becoming of the fact, which can't be accounted for by a chain of conditions, absolute becoming, in the middle of the logic, and then three, absolute idea at the end of the logic. So three absolutes. And two of them, right, absolute knowledge and absolute idea, involve an annulment of time. So between two annulments of time, what Hegel calls absolute becoming is the pure instance of becoming, as the indetermination of a temporal regress through a chain of conditions gives way to the groundlessness of that which comes into the world here and now. This very groundlessness is what is gathered into and included within the whole as the absolute idea. In fact, the whole has to include this movement, this moment of absolute becoming, of groundlessness within it, within its transitionless self-comprehension. Otherwise, it would not be whole. Right? This is a characteristically Hegelian logic, right? That is to say, it would not include its opposite. Right? So in order to include transitionless being, right, the whole has to also include absolute becoming. Right? Otherwise, it wouldn't include its opposite. It would not be whole. This is what Quentin Meillassoux calls the subordination of contingency in Hegel. Okay. There is in Hegel, there certainly is in Hegel, contingency. And there is in Hegel a unity of contingency and necessity. But this unity of contingency and necessity is included within the idea as necessary. Unity of contingency and necessity is included as necessity. That is the necessity of the whole itself. The impasse of Hegel's system is how this double annulment of time from absolute spirit to absolute idea is supposed to be thought coherently, given that thought relies upon the movement of negation for its own critical purchase. That is, in my argument anyway, the epistemology of true critique relies upon the complex becoming of thought between contingency and necessity, between experience and reason, for its self-critical movement. But this self-critical movement is exactly what is annulled in the moment of its transitionless comprehension. So you understand, like, the movement of immanent critique in Hegel relies upon transition between what has to be said and what happens in thought, right? But then we arrive at the annulment of precisely that movement, precisely in the grasping, right, of the movement of the concept. And so we lose, in my analysis, the epistemological coherence, that is to say, its self-critical aspect of immanent critique. At that moment, thought becomes non-critical, right? And I would say, at that moment, thought becomes idealist. It's this impasse in Hegel. This in itself is not necessarily like particularly original, right? Everybody's obsessed with the problem of the whole and like the end of transitions in Hegel, but it's a particular way of understanding it through this methodological argument. So it's this impasse in Hegel's double critique of Kant and of pre-critical metaphysics to which I think the work of Quentin Meillassoux most fundamentally responds and which it seeks to overcome. While Hegel encloses absolute becoming between the bookends of absolute knowledge and absolute idea, Meillassoux places the link between absolute becoming and absolute time front and center in his philosophy. And he does so through a theory of absolute contingency, or what he calls in his doctoral dissertation, unsubordinated contingency. So, in the doctoral dissertation, as opposed to after finitude, it's very clear and it's repeatedly stressed that the entire project of Meillassoux's work is to think absolute becoming and to think absolute becoming in such a way that it is protected from the subordination of contingency and the subordination of becoming by these two annulments of time in Hegelian thought. That is to say, by the figure of the whole. Right, which subordinates contingency by thinking the unity of contingency and necessity as necessity. So, in Meillassoux's sense, how can an unsubordinated contingency be thought? That is to say, what he calls absolute contingency, and what we can think of as the absolute contingency of absolute becoming. How can this be protected from subordination? Or if you want, how can we turn speculative idealism into speculative materialism? It's the way that Hegel or Meillassoux thinks about the problem. Okay, so in the doctoral dissertation, Meillassoux formulates this problem as a question concerning necessity. In fact, right? The problem of contingency is in fact the problem of necessity. And he formulates this problem in a manner bearing upon the relation between rationalism and empiricism. Okay, so Meillassoux poses as the central question of his thought the same question that Kant and Hegel want to answer. He says, and it bears upon the relation between rationalism and empiricism. He says, if reason is not a chimera, then it must resolve this problem. How to disengage amid the factual beings given in experience, that which, adequate to beings as such, is not itself contingent. Okay, so how to disengage, right? If reason is not a chimera, then it has to answer the question of how to disengage amid the factual beings given an experience, that which is not itself contingent. That which is not just a fact, if you want, but rather something necessary. How do you find necessity amid the contingency of the circle of existence, if you want? Okay, so readers of After Finitude will know that Meillassoux attempts to solve this problem by theorizing contingency itself as the only necessity available to rational reflection, the only absolute necessity. That is, by theorizing the necessity of contingency. However, the articulation of this theory proceeds differently in L'Inexistence Divine, in the Doctor of the Citation, than it does in the later and shorter book. And After Finitude, and we talked about this the other day, on the first day, the anhypothetical principle of factiality, right, anhypothetical derived from indirect argumentation, is established through a philosophical dialogue between the figures of the speculative materialist, Meillassoux's position, the dogmatist, the correlationist, and the absolute idealist. And this dialogue, which concerns the fate of the soul after death, is meant to show that the correlationist encounters a double bind, whereby he can only refute both the absolute idealist and the speculative materialist by refuting himself. That is to say, by thinking as absolute the very contingency that he tries to delimit as a condition relative to thought's correlational structure, rather than as a necessary condition of things in themselves. Thus, the anhypothetical demonstration of the principle of factiality relies, in After Finitude, upon the contest of speculative philosophy with the figure of the correlationist. And this is a figure who is as yet unnamed in Meillassoux's doctoral dissertation, right? So in the 400 pages of the doctoral dissertation, the term correlationism is never used. Although there is an analysis of the correlational structure, or the correlation, in Heidegger's thought, 20 pages on Heidegger. But he never uses the term correlationism. And he also, you know, the principle of, the argument concerning ancestrality, the argument from the archaic fossil, which begins After Finitude, is like 2 pages in Meillassoux's dissertation. It's an afterthought in the middle of the volume. So it doesn't have at all the same kind of importance that it does in the other book. Okay, so what happens in the doctoral dissertation, then? How is this? The argument proceeds differently. And I've translated this. It was just published in Parisia in the fall, if you want to read it in English. This argument, an hypothetical argument for the principle of factiality in the dissertation. So in the dissertation, the extraction of rational necessity from the contingency of the given proceeds more directly. Right? There's no dialogue between other philosophical positions. It proceeds through an examination of the concepts of necessity and contingency themselves. So here's my little diagram of the argument, which I'll explain. Okay, so Meillassoux notes that, it's a simple argument, Meillassoux notes that the contingency of a being is not one of its predicates. In the same sense, as its contingent properties. So, while it is contingent that a certain being exists, that it is red, that it is here or there, right, or that it passes out of existence at one time rather than another, the contingency of the being itself cannot be said to be contingent in the same sense. To qualify the predicates of a being as contingent is unproblematic. But to qualify contingency itself as contingent results in a redoubling of contingency, right? Whereby what we would be saying is that contingency itself is either contingent or not contingent. It's either contingent or necessary, right? But if contingency is either contingent or necessary, then it's contingent. Understand? So So this is the diagram of the... Meillassoux calls this the redoubling of contingency. The conditioning of contingency by contingency, or the attempt to condition it by contingency, results in an infinite regress, whereby what is being said is the opposite of what is meant. Right? So what is said is that contingency is necessary, since the redoubling of contingency by contingency only results in contingency itself. So the person means to say, well, contingency is contingent, but what is actually said is contingency is necessary. Okay? So this is the argument. That is, it's impossible to say that contingency may not be without presupposing the contingency of contingency, etc., and therefore returning to the position that contingency must be. Amid contingent beings and their contingent properties, that is to say facts, the circle of existence, ontic reflection in Heidegger's terms, necessity resides in the impossibility of speaking about contingency itself as if it were a contingent being. And the philosophical import of this argument is that it bears upon the ontological difference between beings and being, or between ontic and ontological levels of reflection in Heidegger's terms. Contingency, Meillassoux argues, is not an ontic predicate. Right? That's the point of the argument. When we want to speak of contingency itself in the same sense as we characterize finite ontic properties by saying that they are contingent, we find that the sense of our statement is reversed. Right? The redoubling of contingency ends up saying that contingency is necessary since we cannot apply it to itself without thereby thinking its tautological redoubling. Contingency itself cannot be thought in an ontic sense. The necessity of contingency is an ontological rather than an ontic datum of thought. Right, so contingency is, but contingency is not a fact. Facts are contingent. Okay, right now, if you're Kant, right, then you'll say, this is like the earlier moment of the antinomies, then you'll say, well, obviously you can't speak of contingency in the same way that you speak about ontic predicates because it's a category of the understanding, you know? It has a transcendental status. Right? And this is where Meillassoux's very interesting argument about the necessity, right, of transcendental critique, of insisting upon the contingency of the categories themselves, right, or refusing to decide whether the categories are contingent or necessary, right, then involves this redoubling at another of reflection, whereby you have to take the categories and apply them to their own modality of being. And in fact, Hegel had already said this in his critique of Kant. And the whole thing about going back to Kant also, I think, to refute things in Meillassoux, the question becomes, well, do you take seriously Hegel's critique of Kant? Right? So I take seriously Hegel's critique of Kant. I think it's correct. And so then the question becomes not like, how do I go back to Kant to refute Meillassoux? Because Hegel has already effectively criticized Kant. The question is, how do Meillassoux's arguments bear upon the relation between Hegel and Kant? And that's why Hegel takes up his arguments at exactly that level, by confronting Kant, right, with the figure of the speculative idealist. Okay, so now, as I said, this is work in progress, and now to conclude, but in a way, this is also sort of like the meat of the argument, but I'm gonna do it more quickly, working from notes, and then we can discuss. So, okay. So again, this argument about the redoubling of contingency, the impossibility of it, which is an argument for the necessity of contingency or the principle of factiality, only contingency is necessary, bears upon the ontological difference, as I said, right, in Heidegger's sense. So the difference between the ontic and the ontological, the difference between beings and the being of beings, or if you like, in Hegel's terminology, the difference between the circle of being, circle of existence and the sphere of being, right? Contingency cannot be thought as an ontic predicate. Now for Heidegger, right, an adequate reckoning with the ontological difference had to be traversed by thinking of the relationship between being and time. And of course, so this returns us to the problem of time in Hegel. vis-a-vis the relation between the circle of existence and the sphere of being and their relationship to contingency and necessity. And of course, at the end of Being and Time, this is exactly what Heidegger does, right? He turns to a critique of Hegel and what he calls Hegel's vulgar concept of time, and to the problem of the annulment of time in Hegel. The problem is that in the annulment of time, and through the annulment of time, for Heidegger, the treatment of the figure of the whole in Hegel actually constitutes a forgetting of being. It constitutes a forgetting of being because, implicitly again, in Heidegger's argument, it involves a treatment of the being of beings as a being. Right? That is to say, the totality of beings as a whole. Right? So, Meillassoux is going to think this problem in Hegel of the annulment of time and through the figure of the whole in terms of the subordination of contingency again. Right? By thinking the whole as something that involves contradiction within itself, it has to include contingency but subordinate it to necessity. And this subordination of contingency also involves an annulment of time. And so Meillassoux is going to think, right, a theory of absolute contingency as a theory of absolute time. And this is his way of countering the annulment of time at the end of Hegel's logic. In Meillassoux, what I want to insist on is that the thinking of what he calls absolute time in After Finitude and what he thinks in the modality of absolute becoming in the doctoral dissertation is a purely subtractive thinking of a concept of time. And by which I mean, you cannot think the concept of absolute time in Meillassoux's sense through phenomenological reflection or through empirical determination. Right? It's a modality of time that doesn't obey the forms of intuition in Kant, and it's a thinking of time that doesn't obey the empirical determinations of science. So how do we think that modality of time? We think it in a purely subtractive sense as what Hegel calls absolute becoming, right? As pure becoming, the pure possibility of becoming, which is submitted to no law. It's not submitted to any form of intuition. It's not submitted to any empirical law of physics. Why? Because a concept of absolute becoming cannot be submitted to any law, because it is the becoming of laws themselves, right? If we want to think law in a way which is not eternal and which involves an element of genesis in the becoming of physical laws, right, then we have to think a form of becoming which is not submitted to a law, right? If we're going to think the becoming of law itself. That is to say, absolute becoming has to include the becoming of laws. It can't be submitted to any law of becoming. And that's Meillassoux's concept of absolute time, which is a time that obviously can't then be thought through the empirical determinations of science, right? Or the transcendental forms of reflection, right? Because we think the transcendental forms of reflection are something in a way that Kant can't grapple with, or something that themselves have to have become for a materialist position. One way to think about this is that we think time as pure exteriority. Okay, and this is exactly what Heidegger wants to do. So here are three passages that I had as my epigraphs for the paper. Right? In Hegel, time therefore appears as the destiny and necessity of spirit that is not yet complete within itself in the phenomenology. Right? So only as that which is not yet complete within itself is temporal. In Heidegger, being of time, in my view, most important sentence in Being and Time, incredible sentence. He says, temporality is the primordial outside of itself, and then note, in and for itself. Now, that is a non-correlational proposition in Heidegger, a thinking of the in itself, in and for itself. Temporality is the primordial outside of itself, in and for itself. And then in Meillassoux, a passage that I'll come back to in a second. So Heidegger wants to think the relation between being and time in a way that does not subordinate time to the whole, that does not annul time in order to subordinate it to the whole, as in Hegel. And he does that, crucially, however, through a thinking of the relation between temporality and finitude, right? Through a phenomenological analysis of the relation between time and finitude. And that's why Heidegger's thought becomes correlational, because it's grounded in an existential analytic, right, that is predicated upon finite forms of thinking. So the problem is, how can the finitude of Heideggerian thought grasp that time, temporality, which he says is the primordial outside of itself, in and for itself, right? And this problem of the relation between the pure exteriority of time in and for itself and the finite forms of thought through which it has to be accessed by phenomenological reflection is the reason, arguably, why Heidegger could not complete the third division of being and time, right? On the thinking of being qua being as time. But he gestures towards what his thinking of being qua being as time would be in this sentence. That is to say, one has to de-suture the exteriority of time in and for itself from the finitude of Heideggerian reflection. And this is exactly what Meillassoux attempts to do through his critique of what he'll end up calling correlationism, and by calling his book After Finitude. And how does he do it? He calls it After Finitude because he's working on the basis of Bourdieu's disarticulation of the relationship between the infinite and the whole. Right? So in Bourdieu's Being and Time, right, Heidegger has to destroy the whole in Hegel through the finitude, right, of phenomenological thinking in order to remain critical. But after Bourdieu, right, Bourdieu shows that we can think the infinite without subordinating it to the figure of the whole. And that's what we gain from Bourdieu's ontological mobilization of Cantorian transfinite mathematics. Right? So now, unlike Hegel, we can de-suture the infinite from the whole. And we can de-subordinate, then, time from the figure of the whole as well, I'll argue. What this allows in Lacan, in Bourdieu, in Meillassoux, is for one to think the not all beyond finitude. Right? It's no longer finitude which institutes the not all, which detotalizes the whole. But we can think the infinite as the not whole. Thus, we disarticulate Hegel's linking of the infinite with the whole, and his subordination of contingency to the whole as the infinite, right? Which therefore has to include the contradiction between contingency and necessity within it, as necessity, as the necessity of the infinite. So thinking this insubordination of contingency, Meillassoux's project is to think this insubordination of contingency liberated from both the finite and the whole through a thinking of time as absolute contingency. And so absolute contingency becomes the very concept of this subtractive thinking of time, right? If we say, in what modality of reflection do we think about this subtractive notion of time that you have in mind, which is neither scientific nor phenomenological, the answer to the question is, we think it modally as absolute contingency, or what Hegel calls absolute becoming. So just to wrap up then, last couple sentences. Crucially, right, Meillassoux links the thinking of absolute contingency to his upholding, right, of the principle of non-contradiction. Right, so his argument will be that the principle of factiality, the necessity of contingency, relies upon the principle of contradiction and also institutes the principle of contradiction. Because if a being were contradictory, right, it would not be contingent. It would be necessary. Why? Because it would include contingency and necessity precisely in this form of the whole of Hegel's annulment of time at the end of the logic, right? It wouldn't have to change. It could be both at once. It wouldn't have to move between contingency and necessity, which is exactly the dialectical engine of Hegel's thought right? Which is then canceled at the end of the logic. My argument about this actually is that Hegel, for his part, in fact does uphold the principle of non-contradiction. He says he doesn't, but it's not true. Throughout the majority of the logic, throughout the critical section of the logic, Hegel upholds the principle of non-contradiction. He does not cancel it. Why? Because every contradiction in Hegel has to generate a movement outside of it. That is to say, the things cannot remain contradictory, right? Their contradiction generates becoming, and that's the very movement of becoming that Meillassoux has in mind when he upholds the principle of non-contradiction. However, the moment in which the principle of non-contradiction is canceled in Hegel is the end of the logic through the annulment of time, the annulment of transition, right? Now, we scrap the principle of non-contradiction and we are truly in the contradictory necessity of the whole. The whole is contradiction. And the whole is contradiction in the modality of the unity of necessity and contingency subordinated to necessity. So, Meillassoux wants to think beyond this subordination and to shatter the alignment of the identity of thinking and being, even as he thinks this non-identity of thinking and being in a mode of ontological reflection. And Meillassoux wants to uphold the relationship between absolute becoming and the principle of non-contradiction. And so he says in this quotation, from l'inexistence divine, on the import of the principle of non-contradiction. The principle of non-contradiction thus says the same thing twice. The object cannot cease to be contingent. Time cannot abolish itself in time. That's his argument against the annulment of time in Hegel. And the crux, I think, of his entire philosophical project. When he makes such an argument, he links the fact that time cannot abolish itself in time to the necessity of contingency. The object cannot cease to be contingent. And in my view, this would be the coherent way of completing the third division of being and time and upholding the pure exteriority of temporality as the primordial outside of itself, in and for itself. Well, thanks.